And then we find out later that it's that Robin has always sort of secretly wanted to be an investigator. It's what she's always wanted to do, and so she kind of, that's why she's got an aptitude for it. And so slowly, as the novels progress, she moves from temporary secretary to full-time secretary to sort of slowly becoming his partner, really, his detective partner.
What's she like as a person? How would you describe her?
She's very warm, but she's very warm. She's very likable. But she's also very driven. I think she's someone that has a lot of kind of confidence. That where do people, when people have confidence in themselves, that they can deal with kind of anyone in any situation. And she's definitely never feels like a fish out of water. Even though she's from small town Yorkshire, but she's kind of at the world that she's learning about through Strike. It's kind of, she's, even though she's in her kind of mid-late 20s, it's sort of, I guess, one of the first times that she's kind of been experiencing a lot of the, like, sex of society that she is privy to through her work with Strike. But she's definitely got this kind of likeable comfortability, and I think she's got a strong sense of her own morals, and that kind of, and that drives her through, and that kind of, that sort of moral backbone drives all her actions and how she thinks about things. And she's got a sort of a goodness, but she's driven, and I think she can be quite almost, there's some sections where she can be quite self-defensive, actually. She can be quite, jump to sort of being defensive if she's criticised, because and if she feels undervalued, and I kind of quite respect her for that. She's got a kind of a ballsiness that I don't have, anyway.
In what ways do you most closely identify with her as the character?
It's funny, like, reading the books, I was just thinking, well, she's just me. But I think that so many women reading the books think that about Robin, because we can all identify bits of ourselves in her, or bits that we want to be. I mean, we all want to be as kind of confident and self-assured and driven as Robin, and we all want to be as moralistic and as good and as true to ourselves as she is. And so sometimes I think she's like best of me on a good day. and I think there's an awful lot of women who do think that. I mean, I haven't spoken about this with Joe, actually, but I have heard that people have said that there is a lot of Joe and Robin, or that Joe has said that there's a lot of her and Robin. But it's amazing how many women I've spoken to that see themselves in her. And so in that respect, she's sort of, we all know her, either in ourselves or in our friends.
What does she like about Strike? Because there's a real spark between them, even though she's engaged to someone else, there's a spark between them. She seems to admire when he goes back to work and that kind of thing, doesn't she?
Yeah, absolutely. I think Robin's a woman of integrity, and I think she admires people of integrity. And Strike definitely is. He's someone that is unashamedly true to himself. And I think this kind of, and so Robin admires his drivenness and also his discretion. There's no kind of showiness to him, there's no falsity, and that's what she admires. And I think Robin and Strike, because of that, they're both kind of similar in that way. They get to know each other quite slowly, and the viewers get to, or the readers get to know them slowly too, through that. And I've always, even like towards the end of book three, and the end of the third series, I always still question how much Robin is even aware that she is probably in love with Strike. I don't think she knows, you know, in that way. It's like, because her admiration of him is so caught up with the kind of freedom that he's allowing her by becoming herself and by doing what she's good at. It's like, her admiration for him is so caught up in her love for the job. And I think they're kind of two things that she, or you can't quite separate in their kind of feelings, and even happened in book three. So yeah, I'm dying to know what happens in book four.
What have you talked with J.K. Rowling about? For you mentioned you hadn't talked to her about how that worked with her being part of Robin's character, but
yeah,
what have you talked to her about?
We haven't talked a load, actually. We've met and chatted, and you know, I've heard her notes through producers or whatever, but everything's always simply very positive, and I think she does write in such a way that it's just so clear. I mean, you know, we all love the world of Harry Potter because it's so meticulously written, and you know, and well-rounded and believable, and it's whole and it's solid, and the same with the characters in the Strike series. It's like, we know who Strike is, and we know who Robin is, and I think that there's kind of a clarity in that that Ruby doesn't need much discussion.
I loved what you said earlier about women identifying with Robin or wanting to identify with Robin. Do you see any other particular women's issues coming out through the narrative of the stories?
Yeah, I mean, I sort of don't know how much we're saying now, but we all read them and don't know what we found out about Robin in by book three, and how the sort of the strength that she must have in herself to pull herself out of that experience. And that's something that was, as much as like in book one and book two, it's like I'm reading Robin and seeing lots of myself in her, and then it was only when sort of that experience came out that I realised there's a lot about Robin that I don't know, that I don't understand. And so I read a couple of great memoirs that was very, I mean, I don't know what kind of research Joe's done, but it was so, a lot of, like Alice Siebel's memoir, and memoir by this woman called Nancy Venerable Rain. There's just that, and their experiences and their feelings as a woman post that assault, and the way that you can beat yourself up for not getting on with it, and it's like it's so associated with like post-traumatic stress disorder, and it is, and the way that, and it kind of a lot of Robin's character that I don't associate with myself all of a sudden started to make sense when I read a lot of, particularly Alice, and in fact both of those memoirs actually were very out in terms of Robin's character, and a lot of the kind of her self-defensiveness and her drive, and it's like even more of a drive because she's not going to let this experience affect her, and she's not going to let this experience define her, and so that it's like she becomes more driven and unafraid in her fear of feeling like she might not be driven or it might have affected her.
What's it like taking on a character that people are so passionate about? You know, they've seen her, they've read her, you know, they want to see Robin. Is that quite daunting?
Well, like, you know what, it's so funny because I haven't read the books. I mean, I knew that they were like, I knew that they were successful, I knew that they were like bestsellers, but I didn't know very many people that have read the books when we started. I was also reading the books, and I was doing a film in Eastern Europe, in Georgia, you know, I was kind of reading there, and then I was like thrown straight full on into work, and I went to a wedding at Christmas when we'd shot most of the first block, and then I met so many women at the wedding that were just like, oh, you're playing Robin, I'm so excited, like, she's just like me, she's just like my sister, she's just like my mate, isn't she amazing, and don't we all love her? And then I was like, oh god, pressure, you know, it was like, oh, yes we do, I thought that was just me, oh no, she's just like you too, so then I was just like, oh crap, I hope everyone thinks I've done her justice and I'm not just playing it like I see her. But I am playing it like I see her, but that's my job, I suppose.
So of the three books, which one, or of the three stories, which do you prefer? Or do you have a preference?
I mean, four, it was definitely book three. It was the most kind of gritty, like, teeth into as an actor to portray. But there's something about, I mean, they all, each novel sort of has a completely different tone and a different atmosphere because it's kind of embodies different social levels of London. And I love book two for it's kind of, it's got this like slightly grotesque, garish, like, but glamorous kind of feel to it. And then you jump to book three, and it's kind of you're back to kind of a grittier realism, and that sort of dirty and grungy London that we kind of that feels more real, even though it's, you know, because so we sort of, and I don't know which one though. I don't know which one of.
Have you had any stunts to do? Because I know in book two, particularly, there's a big car chase and all that kind of thing. Enjoyed those kind of things?
Oh, I love that. I love it. I mean, driving the Jeep, Robin's Land Rover, that is in, that's book three. I loved that. And it was very much kind of like attached to it. And it's one of those Land Rovers that was, it was 1960s Land Rover, it was really hard to drive. And so I felt like it was always quite proud of myself. Like, you know, I knew how to drive it. Once the first AD got into trying to reverse it and couldn't do it, I'm like, get out, I'll show you how it works. It definitely felt like my car. Because I knew the tricks of how to start it. Also there's sort of a rent-a-car chase in book two. I mean, it's so rare that someone goes, can you just drive as fast as you can across this muddy field and swerve a bit? And you're like, okay. It's like a go-kart in a real car. So that was fun. And there were some other bits of stunt in the second book as well. Like, we've been getting hit over the head and having to, like, battle these tassels. Liz tasseled to the ground, and I love that stuff. I mean, especially like when we're filming, and we're in the studio a lot, and of course it's like there's a lot of plot, so there's a lot of kind of narrative that is out through talking. So there's lots of when, and particularly scenes in the studio, it's lots of Robin and Strike talking, and it's like there's lots of exposition of story, and it's all very dialogue heavy, and so. When you get out from behind your desk and you get to drive a car in the middle of a field, you know, it definitely breaks up the working week a bit.
What do you think makes it different from other types of detective shows?
I think that Robin and Strike, I think it's quite a sort of character-driven piece. It's like, I mean, I know a lot of detective novels are, but they're quite often, like, detectives have their quirk, and I suppose Strike's quirk is he's got one leg. I mean, he has a history. It's like when we get to know his, like, he is a product of his history, and you know, I feel almost like it's the detective story comes, it's almost secondary to the story of Strike in his life. And and I think also it's quite accessible in terms of the fact that Robin isn't a detective. She hasn't trained. She has done slightly as the series progressed. So we're from the beginning, as an audience, you're seeing these cases through Robin's eyes, and she is you're kind of learning with her in a way. And it's not a story about like two honed and polished detectives. A story about a kind of an interesting, damaged man and a young woman that's learning this craft, and so you're more open for kind of mistakes, and it's not a story about a sort of detective that gets it right all the time. It's like there's two people sort of learning about each other.
Do you have a favourite moment from the set?
I mean, it was about 6 months shoot, so I don't know if I have. What's a favourite moment in the whole shoot? Driving around in the car was pretty fun, to be honest. Like, that was pretty great. Driving Tom through the woods, being trusted. I've got to say, he's very bloody trusting with me in the car. Like, you know, in both the rental car and the Land Rover, Tom would just be happily sitting there while I'm like twirling off down the roads, trying not to kill him.
So you were talking earlier, of course, about women's issues, and then you were mentioning how, you know, these stories are incredible because they're so multi-layered, you know. And I know that veterans' issues are addressed, you know, the nature of fame is addressed, the, you know, family relationships, the definition of love. Other than, you know, what you were talking about with the women's issues, what other issues did you find the most interesting, or the topics the most interesting?
Well, I mean, I always love a love story and a relationship drama, and it, I think a lot of Robin's issues, or Robin's kind of stories, is this young woman, or this girl, really, like, learning to be herself, and because of her... Because of, you know, the horrendous rent that sort of happened at uni to her, it's almost like her career and her self-progression as a young woman has kind of been stilted. And so even though she's in her mid to late 20s, it's like she's like someone that is just leaving uni now and just learning to be who she is. And that, and so that I find her relationship with Matthew... like really interesting, because it's like it's just this kind of this element of Robin that is kind of like she's come from an area of safety with this long-term relationship and with this like loving family in this small town, and she's only just breaking out of that in her late 20s. A lot of people do that in their late teens, you know, but it feels like she's kind of she's just learning things about herself and having this kind of bravery to step out of that. And I think Strike, this new job and this sort of, and her friendship with Strike is kind of helping her kind of develop her sense of self. So that is kind of get issues of kind of growing up, being yourself, and having the bravery in relationships to be yourself and to grow up. And, you know, it's a lot of Matthew and Robin's relationship is kind of you're watching them grow apart, and when will they admit that to each other, you know.
Are there any guest cast you particularly enjoyed working with? She's got some great guest stars in each story.
Yeah, Monica Dolan?
She's in the second one.
She is so brilliant. I just watched the first step of the second one. I've like really annoyingly watched like two of the first, one of the second, and one of the third, but I haven't like seen all of them yet. But she is so fucking good, and like a lot of that story, book two is quite. The story in book two is quite out there. It's quite big. It's quite grotesque. It's not the total like realism and sort of. Reality of London that you sort of have in different aspects of book one and book three. And so I think book two, you need to, in order for you to even care the outcome of the story, you need to, the central character of, oh God, who does she play? Lenora and her daughter Dodo, you need to have, you need to invest in them, and so they need to be, you know, that the characters need to invest in the characters, so the actress portraying them needs to like be great. And Monica's just like so many complex levels to Lenora that I almost like, it was amazing, like, you know, you always know J.K. Rowling's characters when you read the books, but I almost didn't quite know who Lenora was until I watched Monica play it, and you're like, oh wow, she's great, she's really great. And so Sarah that plays Dodo, her daughter, and so that kind of that the just the like heartstrings tugged in that relationship, I think really worked.
What do you think was gained from doing it as a little mini series instead of doing it as like one long episode?
That's all you kind of have to, because that's what the books are. Like the books are so different. They have such different tones, and so I think you, and so hopefully like we have, you know, different directors, different DOPs, quite a lot of different crew actually between the books. So, and I think, you know, producers were, you know, you get a lot of long series, particularly American series, and it's like the tone is set, and even sometimes the directors might set up the first episode, and then they even have like, sometimes they even have shot lists of like what they're allowed, what shots they're allowed to do, and you know, in this room we have the lighting like that, and we come, this is how we shoot a mid shot on this lens or whatever. And this was definitely not the case. You know, each director and DOP was given free rein between each book to create the tone that they wanted. And I think that's important because the novels are all very different, and I think they do have different tones, and the only through line really is Robin and Strike. And I think that's what's sort of interesting about it, is you get these two people that you're getting to know, and you're getting to know them through different situations and different different levels of London, really. Yeah. So I sort of think I couldn't imagine it working as a full series. It wouldn't have been as interesting. I think there's something interesting about it being embracing the fact that they're totally different stories.
A bit of a potty question now. How would you sort Robin? The house, would you put her in? Harry Potter house.
Oh, what? How would I sort Robin in the Harry Potter house? She's definitely not Hufflepuff, and she's definitely not Slytherin. I'd say she definitely has the bravery of Gryffindor. What is it for Ravenclaw? What sets Ravenclaw off?
Intelligence.
The sorting hat would probably have a bit of a chat to itself about whether to put her in Ravenclaw or Gryffindor. And had she have been sorted before uni, she'd have probably been put in Ravenclaw. But if she'd have been sorted after uni, she would be put in Gryffindor.
Good answer. Yeah. You've done a lot of period stuff. Was it lovely to do something so contemporary?
Jeans, trousers. You know what? This sounds so ridiculous, but the practicalities of having pockets and having a handbag. Because I always get, you know, if you leave your trailer at the beginning of the day, you don't go back to it at night. If you have your phone or your book or your purse, to actually be able to carry my own purse with me so that I'm not like asking runners if I can borrow petty cash every time I want a cup of coffee. So, you know, actually, really, when you're filming in London and you can have your money in your phone, it's so liberating, I tell you. Thank God Robin has a handbag.
Was there a location that you really enjoyed specifically?
Oh, it's great being in Soho. It's such a weird novelty. Working in Soho, sometimes being in your work clothes, like Robin's clothes in Soho, it's slightly like abstract and sort of out there because you associate that so much with it. It's like your character stepping on your turf is really weird.
Sorry, I have to switch you around. I'm so